What if we attacked Poland the historical way? Welcome to a rather unusual video, everyone. Here we'll be using historically accurate divisions, tactics, plans, and equipment to recreate some of the greatest battles of World War II and see how well they work in Hearts of Iron 4. And just because I like to torture myself, I'll skip all microing and rely entirely on battleplans for our first mission, which is the German invasion of Poland. I also have some tips on how to get better at waging war later in the video, so make sure to watch it until the end. Now I'll get right into it from the 1939 start, which is historically accurate in terms of the forces used by the German in the operation they called Fallweiss. We'll begin with a war criminal roll call. The invasion force consisted of two army groups, North and South. Army Group North was led by Theodor von Bock, which starts as a four-skilled general. This guy was one of the most prominent officers in the German army and was eventually promoted to field marshal after his subsequent success in France. He was even appointed to lead the biggest army group tasked with taking Moscow and Barbarossa, but we all know how that ended. Now, I did promote him to field marshal a bit early, as generals can't lead army groups in HOI4. Under him we have the 3rd Army stationed in East Prussia, led by General von Küchler, and the 4th Army led by Field Marshal von Kluge, stationed in Pomerania. Meanwhile, Army Group South was led by Field Marshal von Rundstedt, who controlled 3 armies: the 8th under General Blaskowitz, the 10th Army under Walter von Reichenau, and Wilhelm List's 14th Army. Now, von Reichenau is not included in Hearts of Iron 4, likely due to the atrocities that resulted after he issued the severity order on the Eastern Front, so I substituted him with Hermann Hoth, who led an army corps in the 10th Army. Besides these armies, we also have around 2,500 aircraft, fighters, CAS, and tactical bombers that we'll use to try and recreate the surface of the moon in Western Poland. So let's draw up the battle plans and proceed with the attack. For the Polish campaign, Army Group North had 2 main tasks: securing the Polish corridor by attacking the area around Danzig and blitzing through the north to attack Warsaw. With the 3rd Army, I'll pick these 3 divisions here, issue a spearhead order to Danzig, and then follow up with a general attacking order in the surrounding 3 provinces. In the middle of East Prussia we have 7 divisions, including a tank division, so we'll spearhead towards Warsaw, then destroy the pocket that we create and continue to attack in the east. One useful tip here is if you want to chain attacking orders but the battle plan paint tool doesn't seem to comply, you can use the tab key to select where the follow-up attack order should begin from. For example, here I want to beeline to Warsaw, create a pocket and then attack it, and then continue attacking the east. So I draw up multiple arrows and chain them one after the other with the tab key. You're going to know that the follow-up attack is properly set up if it contains the same number of divisions you've selected and the arrow's color is entirely filled. For example, if you see the white stripes and a no division sign, you have to delete the arrow and then draw another one and use tab to set it up until it's right. The remaining 3 divisions in East Prussia aren't exactly the cream of the Wehrmacht, so you can choose to hold the front, but I will still issue attacking orders to pin some of these Polish forces here. As for the 4th Army in northeast Germany, we will grab our 4 motorized and tank divisions, use them to spearhead to Torun and then attack the pocket that will form, while all the infantry will attack the area from Danzig to Warsaw. We can move on to Army Group South now. The 8th Army will have a similar attacking order but from the south, mostly preoccupied with destroying the cauldron that will form north from Warsaw. We do have a special motorized division here, but it is quite small, so we won't be blitzing with it. Now here's where things get interesting. The 10th Army contains the bulk of our tank and motorized divisions, so it will be doing the heavy lifting in Poland. I'll select all these mobile forces and direct them straight to Warsaw with a spearhead order, and then they will proceed to Radom and Kowel and Lviv. The 9 remaining infantry divisions will get a similar but more broad attacking order. We're left with the 14th Army. It also has some mobile forces, so we'll use them to punch a hole in the front, roughly at the same location as the tanks of the 10th Army, but then I'll drive them south to create a pocket around Krakow. Krakow is a tougher nut to crack compared to what happens in real life, so we'll have to adapt a bit here and avoid a direct assault on the cities before they are encircled. Okay, we're ready for action, so let's wait until 4 a.m. on the 1st of September and see how it goes. Historically, Poland fell on the 6th of October in real life, leaving 45,000 killed and wounded German soldiers and 200,000 casualties on the side of the Poles. Keep in mind that the Soviets also attacked from the east in real life and influenced the campaign, something that doesn't happen in HOI4. Now that we've established the benchmark, let's see how we'll do. I will execute all attack orders and leave the AI to do the rest. There will be no micro, as I said earlier. Okay, so the AI was able to follow my orders decently. We did form pockets where we wanted, we destroyed them, and we defeated the Polish army in about 21 days, or over 2 weeks earlier than what happened in real life. Our losses stand at 14,000, or around 4 times lower than what's quoted in Wikipedia, while we have inflicted 392,000 casualties on the Polish army. As you can see, we can wage war effectively without having to micromanage our units, but it's fair to say that it does take more time to draw up detailed battle plans, and we certainly run the risk of not involving all possible divisions and battles as the front lines change, so our generals might miss out on gaining extra traits and experience. On the bright side, not controlling your units directly will allow them to retain the attacking bonus they get from planning for much longer, allowing them to maintain their attacking momentum in the latter parts of the operation. Now, this is not the end of the video. As I mentioned, I will give you a few useful tips that can yield even better results when you try this on your own. First of all, the division templates for infantry and tanks in the 1939 start date are not what I would describe as historical. If you want to, you can start in 36 and gather enough experience from the Spanish Civil War and the Sino-Japanese War to craft divisions that are more closely following historical norms. To your regular infantry division, I would suggest adding a line arty and anti-tank battalions, support anti-air, a cavalry recon company, and a signal company. The motorized infantry division template looks quite similar. You can add motorized line arty and anti-air, then include support anti-tank, signal, arty, engineer, and motorized recon companies. Finally, you can expand your tank divisions by adding an extra medium tank battalion, plus motorized anti-tank, arty, and anti-aircraft battalions. The support companies for tanks are engineers, logistics, signal, maintenance, and armor car recons. Keep in mind that the tanks used are the Panzer II, Panzer III, roughly equally split for light tanks, and the Panzer IV for your medium tank brigade. Of course, these are not the most effective divisions you can build. They do cost a lot of XP, but they are certainly more powerful than what you initially start with, and are quite close to what was used historically, which sort of is the point anyway. Don't forget to produce enough equipment to have these divisions fighting at full strength, otherwise you'll just make your troops weaker and waste army XP. And talking about army XP, don't forget to use it on Spirit of the Academy, Army, and Division Command. The ones I recommend are Bold Attack, Quick Improvisation once you get the Makeshift Bridges command, and Maneuver Warfare for the extra speed and coordination. As for Spirit of the Air Force, aircrew surveys are good, but you can definitely spend a bit of air XP to save political power with the independent Air Force spirit. As for the Air Force command, centralized control is great, but airborne heroes are also an interesting choice depending on how you level up your doctrines. I will share some more useful tips in my next video, in which we'll try to emulate the famous Ardennes offensive and conquer France. And if you like this no micro challenge, I will try to win by only using battle plans Blitzkrieg there too. Thanks for watching, remember to leave a like and subscribe, and I'll see you next time.